Hey guys, I wanted to update a video I did a few years ago about flashing the GT3B with the hacked firmware by PSX. I also want to elaborate on the procedure and bring up some common errors that could potentially pop up. I've flashed a number of GT3s over the years for myself and friends, and recently I got another GT3B from GearBest. Since I'm going to flash it with the hacked firmware anyways, I might as well do an updated video about the process. So the Flysky GT3B is a really good radio for RC cars, trucks, buggies, and boats. For around $50, it's one of the most affordable, fully programmable pistol grip transmitters that you can buy. Not only is the radio inexpensive, the receivers are fairly priced, and if you flashed it with the hacked firmware like I'm going to show you in this video, it unlocks a ton of features like more model memory and up to 8 channels. So in order to flash the hacked firmware, you'll need an STM USB programmer. This one is the one that I use, and you can get them easily online for less than $5. They come in a lot of different colors and different designs, but make sure that it says ST-Link V2 and it says STM8 and STM32, and they should have the swim, ground, reset, and 5-volt connections that you need to hook up to your GT3B circuit board. You will need to do a little bit of soldering, so if you're not comfortable with this, see if you can ask a friend to help you out. Also keep in mind that anytime you flash something, you are taking a risk. Any number of things can go wrong, so go slow, take your time, and double check your connections and cross your fingers. So the very first thing we need to do is take this apart. So the knob has to be popped off, and you could do that with just like something plastic. Try not to use anything metal or else you'll scratch it. So that comes off easy. It just pops off. There's no screws or anything holding it in place. It's just friction fitted. Next thing you want to do is remove these 4 screws on top here. And what you want to do is lift up the antenna. This way it doesn't get in the way when you pry off the cover. So it just uses a Phillips screwdriver and to remove it. And after you do that, in order for you to remove the top cover, you do have to pop off a couple of these tabs. And again, use something that's plastic, like a guitar pick or one of these spludgers. Try not to use a screwdriver because you'll leave some marks. And you just carefully pry it off. And with the antenna up, it'll just pop off really easily. You can now put the cover to the side because we won't be doing anything with this. And the next thing you want to do is remove these silver buttons. They're just going to fall off and get in the way. So there's 3 sets of them for the trim buttons as well as the back end and exit buttons. And just carefully remove those. And now you're left with the main circuit board. And over there, that's where the solder points are for the 5-volt swim, ground, and reset. I'll try to zoom in closer so you can take a look. But I'll show you on the other side, that's where the markings are, but that's the reverse side of where the we're going to solder some wires to. So you want to quickly, carefully lift this up. There is an antenna wire that is attached to the other side of the circuit board, so you want to make sure that you're not going to accidentally rip it off, because then you'll have to resolder it. And so you see the gray wire right there, that's the antenna wire, so you got to be careful with that. Make sure you don't yank it off and just damage it. And on the bottom, you'll see that all the controls, like the dial, the trigger, the battery, they're connected via these wires. And over here, that's the main RF board where the antenna is connected to. I'll try to show you the connection points here, right there, 5-volt, swim, ground, and reset. Let me see if I could zoom in and give you like a still shot of this thing. But that's where we're gonna connect the wires to and program or flash the firmware to the GT3B. And so over here we have these wires and we want to remove them so that we can have better access to it. So they just plug in, so just kind of wiggle them back and forth and just unplug them. So that's the power, and I believe these are for the controls, like the trigger and the steering knob. So just remove those as well. Kind of make note of which goes where, because you don't want to mess that up. So maybe take a picture of it before you take it apart. And now the only thing that is attached to this thing is the antenna wire. Unfortunately, the antenna wire doesn't just pop off. So what I'm going to do is just rest it here in place. And I'll see if I could show you a close-up of the connections here. So the four connections that we're really concerned about is the 5-volt, swim, ground, and reset. And we're going to solder some wires to this so that we can hook it up to our USB programmer. And here is the close-up of it. There are the four connections. So we're just going to use the wire that came with the USB programmer. It comes with these breadboard wires. And what you want to do is essentially just snip off the other end. This way you have something that you can solder to the circuit board for programming. Now with that same wire, you want to push it through the holes here. And on the other side, we're going to use some solder and connect it to the circuit board. If you're not comfortable with this process, find somebody who knows how to use a soldering iron and then they can help you with that. But this is probably the only difficult step that I could find for somebody who's never really worked with electronics. So what we're going to do now is plug those in. And to hold it in place, what I would recommend is that you get some tapes, like some clear tape here, and just to tape the wires down so that when you flip the board over, the wires don't fall out. This way it will hold it in place while you're soldering the wires to the circuit board. And I'll flip it around to show you what it looks like. But use some tape because, you know, it's going to be hard to hold that in place while you're soldering. But before I flip it over, I want to show you that I've already soldered the RST or reset wire here because it's hard to get at the fourth hole, which is under the RF module. So you can solder it under this patch here. And then this way you only have to do the other three on the other side. So here it is on the other side. Since we already soldered the RST wire, the only wires that we have to be concerned about now are the 5-volt swim and ground right here. And you don't really need a powerful soldering iron to do this. I have this 5-volt soldering iron, which is powered by like a battery pack off USB. And these are really good for doing these type of connections because it doesn't require a lot of heat to melt the solder. And I use this quite a bit for most of my projects. And like I said, it's only powered by 5-volt USB, and you can pick these up online pretty much at any of these online retailers. Just try to use as little solder as you can because too much you'll overflow and you might even short something. So try to use as little solder as you can to make these connections. So what do you do with these wires after you're done flashing your GT3B? Typically what I do is I leave it there and I just tuck it away inside the transmitter just in case I have to reflash it or something in the future and I don't have to redo this process. But the firmware hasn't really changed much in the last 7 years, I don't think. So I don't think there's going to be any new version of the hacked firmware since it's almost perfect. So if you want to, you can remove the wiring after you're done flashing it, or you can just leave it inside the transmitter, tuck it away or something. So on the other side where we plug up the breadboard connectors, this is where we will hook them up to the USB programmer. So usually they're on the first row. It depends on the program you have, but the first row is 5-volt, and then you skip one pin and then it's swim. So I'm going to hook this up here. It's kind of hard to look through the camera LCD and see what I'm doing here, but then next we have ground, and then finally we have the reset wire, which goes on position one, I believe, on this particular programmer. So like it depends on the program you have. You may have the wires in different places and your wire colors are different, but just make sure that you have all the wires hooked up correctly, because this is probably one of the biggest mistakes people make, and you will get an error if it's not hooked up right, and you may possibly even damage something. So double check, triple check all your wiring and check all your soldering joints to make sure they're solid, and this way when it comes time to program, it will work. So the very first thing we're going to do is download the GT3B firmware that has been hacked. This is by PSX, and the latest version is 0.61, and it hasn't changed for the last, you know, few years. I don't think there's any new updates or versions coming out, so just go to the GitHub and download it. Right click on raw and then go save link as. I already saved it, so I'm gonna hit cancel here, but it should have an S19 extension. And the next thing we need to do is download the ST visual programmer. So you can get this from st.com. And what you want to do is go to tools and software and click on to software development tools. And we want the version that is for the STM8's MCU. So make sure that it's there. Click programmers. And for some reason, this website is a little slow for me right now. But you want to go to the very bottom. And it says STVP STM8. Click that to expand it. And then go to the very bottom. And it says get software. And let's see here. At the very bottom, there should be a link to download it. Make sure you download this. Right at the time of this video is version 42. Click accept. And this is where you're going to have to either set up an account or provide your email to be able to download this. So when I did this, I think it took like a day before I got a confirmation email to download it. So it may take a little bit longer. It's not like immediate. But anyways, that's how you download the SD software. So once you get the SD software, you want to extract it. So right click, go extract all, and then there should be an executable that you can run to begin the installation. So there it is, double click on that and click yes through all the prompts. And I'll try to speed through this because it's kind of boring. It probably took like 5 minutes to install everything, and it really depends how fast your computer is and whatnot. So if you get this error message about something about Adobe Reader, you can just go okay. You don't really need the reader. Click next, accept the agreement, click next, 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 and next. And this process will take a few minutes, so I'm going to speed through this part right here. So not only will this install the software, the visual programmer, it will also install the drivers for the USB programmer. Once the software is installed, you can plug up your GT3B to the USB programmer and then into your computer. So make note that you don't need any batteries in your GT3B because it's going to be powered directly by the programmer itself. So no batteries are needed. You'll also hear this annoying beeping noise, which is normal because your transmitter is expecting a certain voltage, and because it's connected via USB, it's only 5 volts, so it's the low voltage alarm that's going off. And remember, when we installed the SD software, it should have installed all the drivers for the USB programmer as well. So it should show up in this device manager as ST-Link dongle. Now it's time to start the ST Visual Programmer. Double click on the icon, and then it should start up the application. The very first thing we want to do is configure the programmer. So make sure you have ST-Link set up and port USB, SWIM, and you want the STM8 S105X6 selected. That is the programmer we're using. And click OK. Now you want to click the read button right here. And when you do that, you might see an error message like this. The device is protected. And that's because the stock firmware has the readout protection active. So we have to turn that off. So go to Option Byte, the Option Byte tab. And we want to make sure that it says off, and then we're going to write that and click program, current tab. And now we just disabled the readout protection. And now when you click read, it should read it without any issues. So we'll do that again just to show you. And that's perfect. So now what we need to do is open up the firmware we downloaded from the GitHub. So you want to select that, go open. And if you click this button here, it should write the firmware. And then when you do this, the beeping will also stop. So if you look at the messages now, there shouldn't be any errors or anything, and it should say that it has been programmed. And if you look at the checksum, it should say something like that. And we can read it again just to make sure that we are communicating with the transmitter and we don't have any errors as well. So that's how you flash the GT3B with the hacked firmware. So I want to address another common error that people get, and that's when they click the read button. It says cannot communicate with device. And this error is usually associated with the physical connections of maybe the solder joints or the wiring to the programmer. So you want to double check, triple check, quadruple check all your wiring and your soldering job to make sure that the connections are solid and everything is hooked up correctly, because when you get that error, it's always something to do with the wiring. And to fix it, the only way to fix it is to just make sure the wiring is correct. There are also many other errors that you can run into that I wouldn't be able to anticipate. Try to use Windows 7. I always run into a lot of issues with drivers and stuff with the latest version of Windows, like Windows 10. I have an older laptop that has Windows 7 that I use just for flashing and setting up devices. And if you're still having issues, make sure you check out the RC forums. There are lots of other people that probably ran into the same problem you have. So to check that we have the firmware installed properly, you want to turn it on and then hold down the enter button. And it should flash back and forth and say F061. That tells you that we have the custom hacked firmware installed now. And holding down the enter button will bring you back to the previous menu. And one last thing before we actually start using it is we need to calibrate this transmitter. So to do that, you want to turn your steering knob to the right and then hold down the enter button. And then you'll be brought to this calibration screen where everything is blinking. And the first thing we need to do is calibrate channel 1, which is the steering. And to do that, basically leave the steering in the central position, and then we're going to hit enter. And now we have to go calibrate the left, full left. So turn it to the left and then hold it there and then hit enter. And then to full right and hold it there and hit enter. And now we've calibrated the steering channel, channel 1. Turn your dial so that it says channel 2. And next thing we're going to do is calibrate the trigger here. So leave it at center and hit enter. And now press the button, hold the trigger down, and press enter. And now push it away and hold it there and press enter. Now we've calibrated channel 1 and 2, which are steering and throttle. We go to channel 3 is basically just the button, so we don't actually need to calibrate channel 3, so we're just going to ignore that. It's just this button here. We're going to go to channel 4, and channel 4 is for your battery, and you hit enter. So in this section, this is where you actually enter the value or the voltage of your batteries. And the only way to find that out is if you used a multimeter or a voltmeter. And if you didn't have a multimeter or a voltmeter, the next best thing I would guess would be to fully charge your batteries. And depending on the type of battery you use, you could figure out what their fully charged voltage is. So in the case of the batteries I'm using here, these are nickel metal hydrate, and they are 1.2 volts. And a fully charged set of batteries would be 9.6 volts. So you would enter that in here as the value. And if you're using AA's, AA's are actually 1.5 volts per AA cell. So with 8 of them, it's going to be 12 volts. So that's what you would put here with a fully charged set of AA, so crank that up to 12. Where it really matters here is with LiPo batteries, especially if you have like a GT3C or something and it uses a single cell LiPo. You want to find out what the actual voltage is with a multimeter, because LiPo batteries can be damaged if they are drained below a certain voltage and you're essentially ruining them. So this is where a multimeter would probably be best. A fully charged LiPo battery, I believe, is 4.2 volts, and then when it's depleted, it's about 3.7. So in my case, I measured my batteries, and they are reading at 9.4. So I'm going to put that in there and hit enter, and then hold down the enter button for a couple of seconds, and then you're back to the main menu. The next thing we want to set is the low voltage alarm. So hold down the enter button for a couple of seconds to enter the secret menu. And from here, you want to turn the dial so that you see low power. And this is the low voltage alarm. Whenever it hits this value, it'll start beeping. And it depends on the type of battery you're going to be using. In my case, I would probably set it around 9 volts. But if you are using a LiPo, I would probably set it at like, say, 3.8 to be on the safe side. Maybe even a little bit higher if you're worried about, you know, ruining your LiPo battery. But for me, I'm at 9 volts or even lower than that because I am using nickel metal hydride. And like always, this low voltage alarm matters most for LiPo batteries or lithium batteries because, like I mentioned before, if you drain them completely to below a certain voltage, you'll actually ruin the LiPo batteries. In my case, I'm just going to enter 9 volts since I'm using 8 AA nickel metal hydride batteries. Hit enter, and now we're done with the calibration of channel 1, channel 2, and your battery. And if you want to know about the new features that are available with the hacked firmware, check out my other video here I did a few years ago. It still applies since nothing has really changed. But in this video, I go through all the settings of the new firmware. And I also have another video here which shows you how to assign channels to the various buttons and make use of the extra up to 8 channels that are available with the hacked firmware. Anyways, that's it for this video. I hope you found it useful and that I was able to help you at least get over some of the issues you may have programming your GT3B with the hacked firmware. I'll have everything I mentioned in the description as usual. Have a nice day, and I will see you in the next video.